You're listening to the Compassion Fatigue Podcast with your host, Jennifer Blau. This is Session 41. Well, thank you so much for joining me today on the Compassion Fatigue Podcast. I am so excited and honored to have on the show today someone who has been very influential in my own work in therapy and compassion fatigue. Dr. Charles Figley is the Paul Henry Kurzweck, MD, Distinguished Chair in Disaster Mental Health. He also directs the Tulane University Traumatology Institute and is a full professor in the School of Social Work at Tulane. Dr. Figley is credited with helping to establish trauma and trauma psychology as important fields of study through his body of work, which includes the 2012 Encyclopedia of Trauma, an Interdisciplinary Guide, and he has also helped to establish the current field of compassion fatigue and vicarious trauma, as well as the importance of self-care and having a self-care plan that works towards becoming more resilient to future setbacks for people working with highly distressed people and animals. Dr. Figley is a husband, father, and grandfather, and this busy man splits his time between New Orleans and Tallahassee. You can read more about him by visiting his CV, which I will put in the links at the show notes page, and most of his journal articles and the book, Compassion Fatigue in the Animal Care Community, is available at ResearchGate, and I will also put links to those in the show notes. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Charles Figley. Hi, Charles. Welcome to the Compassion Fatigue Podcast. Thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you, Jennifer. Thanks for inviting me.
Absolutely. I am absolutely thrilled and honored to have you on here. So you have been so instrumental in the field of compassion fatigue, and you have called compassion fatigue the cost of caring or vicarious trauma. For those people who might not understand what vicarious trauma is, could you explain that concept?
Well, compassion fatigue and vicarious trauma are often used interchangeably, but you know, it's just one of the reasons why I love the concept of compassion fatigue is it sort of is the essence of what's going on, because you get fatigued from being compassionate. If you don't have much ability to be empathic, you're not going to get vicarious trauma. Pass the word. You know, if you suck at understanding the emotions of other people, you're not going to get it because you don't feel the pain that you have to take in. So the compassion fatigue and vicarious trauma is experiencing secondarily someone else's pain in order to help them. You don't want to just say, well, let's give me all the pain, please pass me over here the pain. No, you're doing that in order to help them. And that's why there is a cost to this. Because students, like right across the street at the School of Social Work, are kids that have the greatest motivation that you can imagine. And God bless them for moving forward and becoming social workers. They have no idea how impactful someone's emotionality is of losing, of loss, or even remembering loss. So, yeah, unless you're ready for it, it could hit you in the face. It could make you challenge your decision to even decide to go into social work or psychology or any kind of human services profession. So there is a cost, but it's worth it because you're doing, I'm not a religious person, but you're doing God's work. I mean, you're doing for humanity when you are in human service. And it requires you to feel, it requires you to listen carefully and to imagine what it was like. It would be like for you if you went through those experiences in order to figure out the best way of helping, not just to do it, not just to dive into the emotion pool, but rather determine how you can help. What are the needs, whether you're a professional or you're a friend or a family member working with a traumatized person? You need to figure out, how can I help? What do they need? And then do it. But the cost is really, you know, some of the stories stick with you. Some of the images that are conjured up when a client or a customer or someone who needs to bring their dog in to a shelter or to a vet's office, and who have the same pain on their face as someone who brings their child into a pediatric critical care unit. It's hard. So sometimes those kinds of emotionality, those realities, stick with you in part because you haven't quite figured out how to help the person. We figured out the mechanism why secondary trauma sticks, why we have an injury, is that it penetrates. That's what trauma means. It's a wound. There is a penetration through the skin or whatever, through our emotions, through our defenses. And as a result of that, it sticks with us and we lose sleep cost. We sometimes gain weight cost or lose weight cost when it is an excess, when we're unable to, in effect, process that experience and move on, because we have to dig deep down in to get the solution to whatever problem this traumatized or in crisis person has. And in that process, we have to see through their eyes, and sometimes it's not pleasant. But as I said before, there is a cost, but there is a way of getting over the cost. And one challenge is talking too much. So I will pause now.
You know, that makes so much sense, what you said regarding the social worker. So, you know, I'm a therapist, so I get this. And people think, okay, you're a therapist, you sit in your chair all day long, nod your head and say, how does that make you feel? Wow, easy gig, right? Or you work at an animal shelter or a veterinary office, and oh, you get to play with little puppies and kitties all day. How fun, right? People have no idea the reality of any type of helping field. So whether it's trauma therapy and listening to these stories all day long and absorbing this trauma, or seeing, so for example, you have numerous clients that come into the office and they have to euthanize their animal, their pets, their family members, right. Or you work in a shelter or animal control and you're seeing the abuse and the neglect out there. That's going to be traumatizing. I mean, there's no way around that.
Right. There's no way around it in terms of confronting it unless you put blinders on and earmuffs on. I mean, it will be there in your face. I mean, this is not an extraordinary phenomenon here. All of us have been in situations in which we feel almost immediately we're over our head. I mean, think of a auto accident in which someone accidentally hits you and the shock. There was an accident, oldest daughter was driving, and I was in the instructor. We were going to the beach, and she flew over the highway, and she was being cut off, and she compensated and went across the median, but she was able to turn it in a way that's in the direction of the ongoing traffic in this multi-lane highway. But the thing that was shocking is that none of us had ever been in that kind of situation before. And so we tended to ask the same kind of fundamental questions when we see a traumatic event happening at work or if we have it seeing on the highway. What happened? Why did it happen? Why did we act the way we did at the time? When we're thinking back, not at the time. Why have I acted the way I have since that time? And what if this happens again? Will I be able to survive? Will I be able to cope? Those are real and appropriate questions to answer in order to figure out, should I do something about this? No matter what it is, we're trying to find out inside of us what we do next. Where do we go? What should we be doing? But the thing that shocks people, and I include combat-hardened veterans, is the power of emotion that you feel in your body, in the circuitry, and how your body feels in that regard. But yet you can feel the same electricity secondarily, when you're working with someone else and you feel their pain, you experience what they have experienced, or you witness something, which is very much, you're in harm's way, that kind of thing. But in each case, there is a biophysiological reaction that we have, and that there is not only a cost, but it provides a metric for us. Because Jennifer, you worked in a shelter. You know what it's like in addition to being a counselor. And you know how your body responds when there have been just really, really, really big events. So when something less big event happens, you actually are better off. Why? because you know that it has been worse and this is easier. And you've had the experience of adjusting and adapting to that. So my guess is that when we start a new job and we face maybe the first week as an actual employee in a shelter, and we begin to recognize certain events that will happen that will be troubling and difficult, the initial ones are extraordinarily difficult, irrespective of how bad they are compared to the one that happens the next month. But each phase or development, we are more and more sure about what we can handle and what we can't handle. And even the people who have developed compassion fatigue or a bad case of vicarious trauma, they end up, if they stay in the same field, and I hope they do, they find that they're even stronger, or they know what their limits are and don't push themselves to be stronger when they're incapable of doing it. So in each case, they have learned from their challenges and they are stronger as a result of that. We have a phrase in which I think it was Max Cleland, who used to be head of the VA. He was a long-term friend of mine, and he wrote a book called Stronger in the Broken Places. And I think that's really true for secondary trauma and vicarious trauma in whatever context, that yes, it's a setback. Yes, we question our wisdom of whether we should be doing this work, but yet as time goes by and you feel stronger and stronger and you process the experience, yeah, you're better off for that knowledge, and it's going to serve you and the people that you serve.
So it almost sounds like in order to really make this type of work sustainable, it's all about building up that resiliency.
Yes. See, that's the thing. You should be doing this interview because you're much more succinct than I am. I mean, you're exactly
right. I don't know about that.
No, it really is. My wife and I and a colleague from South Africa has worked on this model, the single model of compassion fatigue resilience. And it really comes down to that, because whatever our weaknesses are, whatever our traumatic experiences are, whatever our capabilities are of being empathic, it really comes down to our being able to balance that with things that feed us, that reassure us. For example, social support. I mean, people that call in and talk to you, people that you interview, those things feed us and overcome and enable us to deal with anything that that we face. Again, I will try. So in the model, there are 13 variables. One of the variables is on the far right side, and that is your level, your predicted level of compassion, fatigue, resilience. And what that means is, why are we looking for diagnoses and pathologies? Why don't we figure out how we're doing generally? This is my wife's philosophy, Kathy Regan-Figley. Figure out where we're at right now and where we really need to be if we do get an emotional injury, if we do get exposed to something that is horrific or terrible or difficult or whatever. We need to have built up our resilience to that from day one. Every self-care plan should include not just how you're caring for yourself, but how you're preparing for the future by developing, you know, a robust compassion fatigue resilience or a human resilience. It doesn't really have to be limited to any particular thing, but from the research that I'm familiar with, we were able to put it in a model that accounts at least for secondary trauma and compassion fatigue.
So it almost sounds like what you're saying is we really need to be kind of proactive rather than reactive. One of the main complaints about the medical model is it seeks to manage symptoms. And I think at least psychotherapists and psychologists are saying, hey, wait a minute. No, we really need to be preventing pathology, not waiting until it happens and then trying to do something about it.
Again, you put your finger on it. I think that's very well said. It gets me to thinking, what does medicine do beyond that? And what they're now doing is having wellness programs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
of trying to prevent osteoporosis or put in any kind of malady that emerges over time. And yeah, that's what we're talking about, is not just to correct the flaws that we see in ourself and in being a better person, let's say, but it's also anticipating what we can face in the future. I mean, here's a perfect example. If we shifted away from just compassion fatigue and just looking at human beings, everybody dies. I know this is a shock to some people, especially younger people.
But, speak for yourself, Charles.
Right, exactly. Maybe it's because I'm so much younger than you.
That's probably the case, yeah.
But there's a whole field within social psychology that has studied the implications of when we're reminded of our mortality. Mm. It's terror management theory, and it is terrifying. It is traumatic when we are reminded, and that happens when someone close to us who seemed as healthy as we are. I mean, I started this area, I mean, in the research in 40 years or so, focusing on combat veterans. I'm still doing it, actually. But the thing that is remarkable is that they have been extraordinarily frightened appropriately.
Yeah, yeah.
So when we're able to, and then so people that their age and younger are die around them, it comes far earlier than most people do. And there are a lot of people that thought, oh, well, that's a bad thing. No, it's not necessarily a bad thing. It could be. But in and of itself, and being reminded that you could die at any time, is not necessarily a bad thing, because it helps us in prioritizing. For example, I mean, if you could die today, then we would be doing something very different. I may not be talking to you.
Absolutely. Yeah.
But,
yeah.
But if we recognize that life is short, if we recognize that, that we all die at some time, then it helps us in prioritizing. It helps us in making sure we do attend to things that we can keep ourselves alive. So it's what you're doing and what I'm trying to do as well, and that is give information away and enable people to make choices themselves and to prepare and to not be in despair. I mean, there are a lot of ways of building up one's personal resilience, and the resilience gets you through these roller coaster times. I mean, we have episodic depression, as you know, and there are, it's subclinical as well. And consequently, some people just know. For example, it's very sunny here in New Orleans. If it were overcast, there are a number of people that have problems with that. We now understand that, and it's very predictable. So the more we know about ourselves, and that includes animal care workers who are dealing with trauma, either directly or indirectly, the better we are, because we not only know what we can do, and not be afraid of doing it and stepping forward, but we know what our limitations are, and therefore we don't beat ourselves up if we choose not to do something that may, you know, push our limitations. So the whole thing about working with animals, and who are childlike in most circumstances, and working with the general public, who are just like the people around us, kind of a bell-shaped curve with regard to sensitivity and love and caring and all that sort of thing, it's inevitable that there will be some heartbreaks in that kind of environment. And that's probably why a lot of us, recognizing our own limitations, chose not to do that kind of work. We may be able to do it for a while. I certainly have, in terms of taking care of animals, my wife in particular. As a matter of fact, what I should say more honestly is I assist my wife in her multiple efforts to save animals, including the barrel owl baby that fell from its nest and in our front yard. And, see, everything's fine. There's the funniest thing, but yeah, she's really a nature lover, she is as involved as I am in terms of educating the public about compassion fatigue, and she would she's very generous with her time in terms of helping out professionals in this field.
So I want to circle back to something that you said about trauma and animal care workers, and you said that basically these people deal with trauma directly and indirectly, right? So we talk about euthanasia, animal abuse, animal neglect, and I don't know if people realize that those are traumatic things that you encounter. And so can you kind of talk about the difference between, because I think a lot of people discount those. Well, that didn't happen to me, so, you know, that's not traumatic. Can you kind of explain the difference between primary and secondary trauma?
Let me give you an analogy. You smoke a cigarette and breathe in the smoke, and you blow the smoke into someone's face and they breathe in. It's still smoke, isn't it? It's still
trauma. I love it. Love it. Yep.
Still trauma. And the closer we are to when the person experienced that trauma, whether it's right next to them or viewing it on a television monitor in the next room, it's still impactful. And then, but even as you go out beyond that, so primary trauma is being in harm's way. Secondary trauma is helping people in harm's way. You have a certain sense of responsibility for taking care of other people.
Or animals.
Or animals, exactly.
Yeah, so like what you were saying about the car accident that you had, that's primary trauma.
Yes, absolutely. And my wife, when she heard about the story, is secondary trauma. Because
right.
She wasn't there. She's just getting the secondary smoke and breathing in the trauma from what we relate to her. But, you know, the thing that's so cool about secondary trauma that's also very different from compassion fatigue, from primary trauma is, with secondary trauma, if it's exclusively about that other person that you've been compassionate with, you get over it immediately, your secondary trauma immediately when they improve. Because you almost have a sense that you had to suffer at least a little bit in terms of feeling the pain, but it resulted in something fantastic and the person feels better.
Okay, so what about the case of, I mean, millions of animals are euthanized every single year in shelter. So that's like this chronic trauma that doesn't have a happy ending. Is that something that can contribute to compassion fatigue and vicarious trauma? Because it doesn't have that happy ending.
Right. Well, yes and no. I've talked with a number of people that work in vet's offices, and people bring in their pet knowing that the pet's not going to be able to make it. And they are given the choice of whether to take the dog or cat or whatever out of its misery, quote unquote, right? Would love to examine those words and all that sort of thing. Whose misery would be a follow-up question for me. But the reality is, and this goes for human beings as well, my mother died in hospice and we were all with her and all that sort of thing. But she suffered quite a bit toward the end. And were it not for hospice, she would have suffered tremendously. And I think that in my interviews and discussions with animal care workers, those that were involved in the euthanasia process, and now, Jennifer, you need to speak up too, because you have far more experience than I do in this area. But from what they told me is they have a certain sense of peace because it brings peace to the living.
Well, you know, I guess what I will say is I did sign up for euthanasia because I knew that that animal's life was going to be put to an end. And in many cases, the euthanasia tech is going to be not only the last person, the last human that that animal will ever interact with on this earth, but sometimes, in some cases, it's going to be the kindest interaction that animal has ever known.
Oh, yeah.
That is what made me make peace with the euthanasia process. However, I will say there's a huge difference in looking into the eyes of an animal that you can almost sense is begging you, please put me out of my suffering, take me out of this world, and a little kitten or a little pit bull puppy that we just don't have room for or is sick and we don't have the resources to put towards. That is a huge moral dilemma. Anyway, that's just my take.
Well, I think that my hope is that this stimulates a lot of discussion because these things are necessary. No one disagrees with that. But the process of making peace with yourself, because
I don't pretend to even imagine knowing what the answer to that question is. The thing that I do know about, though, is traumatic injury, and I know about moral injury, in that we've studied this, and it's been really an important emergence since PTSD was invented. I think it's probably one of the most important concepts that has been invented. And that is that the moral injuries that we experience that cause trauma that we can't put our finger on, but yet, just like with a real trauma that took place at some point in time, it remains active until we figure it out. And there's a doctoral student of mine just started this year from Israel, Michal, and she is focusing on the meaning of secondary trauma. And she first has to deal with and address the meaning of trauma, then secondary trauma, because we know that they're both linked. And another colleague of mine, also from Israel, Kobe Stein, he and I and Zahava Solomon, also from Israel, we have been kind of investigating that way of looking at traumatic events. In other words, to see it as the meaning is the thing. The meaning is important. Mm. And what we're suggesting is that there's a traumatic event like a kitten that has to be put to sleep because of the lack of a room, you know, that kind of thing. Let's say that that is the moral injury that happens to, let's say, someone who volunteered to do this. The moral injury is one in which there's a violation of one's own inner core. Sometimes we don't know what that is.
Yeah.
And so part of the therapy is sort of like drilling down, like they're drilling down to get the, get your teeth fixed. You know, drilling down in order to really, what is it about that person? Long before they became worked in a vet's office or whatever in terms of working with animals, that is connected to their sense of being and their sense of morality, because the quicker and the more familiar we are to that core, those core beliefs or those core sensibilities, I would put it, because it's more than just beliefs. It's a feeling that you have, but you have to articulate it, obviously, but it's never discount the feelings, because if people talk about skin crawling and cold chills, it's that kind of a physiological, tactile, kinesthetic kind of reaction. And one of the reasons why I'm talking a little bit more about this is that I hope it will conjure up something in people that they'll help us identify it, because we know it when we see it, and we've tried to describe it as much as possible, it meaning this inner core. But the process of discovery is something that we haven't quite worked out yet. But it goes back to what we were talking about with regard to the kitten and the shelter and potential for compassion fatigue. To me, that's more than compassion fatigue. That's essentially, you're in direct trauma, because you're crossing a line. You're not enjoying this. You're doing this to a certain extent against your will. And that can be traumatizing. And if it's memorable, then it's even more likely that it's traumatizing. The memories that we have, I've said a long time ago when I first talked about PTSD in my 1978 book, 3 years before PTSD was invented, 2 years before, was essentially the idea that we are how we feel, and we feel, and the way we are is the way we have to be. In other words, we're working in the public, we have this kind of challenge or difficulty with regard to your job, in effect, but you can't look like you're in pain or anything like that. You just have to act normal, or people are going to ask you about it. So there is this kind of like dualism, and that we're getting to that as well with regard to the way of finding, you know, that spot. But the notion of with PTSD, right? We talked about PTSD really using the concept of catastrophe, because we didn't want to suggest that if my challenge for me with post-traumatic stress disorders, first of all, it's post-traumatic. That means it's already over. And so that right there is illogical. But the main thing here is that it's more of a catastrophe. In other words, it's a potential traumatic event rather than a traumatic event, but because by definition, it's traumatic. So a more accurate way of describing it is either pre-trauma or a catastrophic event that may become traumatic. But either way, there is an injury. There's something that happens at a particular point in time that you may not remember extraordinarily well, but eventually you can with the right support. That gives the best evidence of where it goes in the core of us, primarily because the context will help us understand, you know, the context will point the way. So with combat veterans, I've studied, I don't know how many, hundreds and hundreds, and lots of publications. But for them, the traumatic injury happens often in terms of morality, when they're shooting their weapon, when they feel that they've failed and someone has died, when they have this tremendous sense of loss and that they had anything at all to do with it. I mean, tiny bits. We had a 3-year study looking at combat medics, and it really came through to us because we interviewed 17 of them, 31 hours of war stories. And really what comes through is with those combat medics, that I don't think they're really different than any other person when you look at the context, because it wasn't so much the guys that, and kids, even civilians that they saved, it's those that they did not save, and they're wrestling with themselves with regard to their responsibility, and that it takes another medic or someone like me who's, you know, done this and know a lot of stories to say, are you crazy? No way. And then how in the world could you do that? You had 3 hours of sleep. You know, I just list all the things that were the context. So if they hold on to it, it means that there is something inside of them that's associated with failing somebody. Does that make any sense at all?
I think it does. And it brings to mind, you know, I wonder, do you think that having a personal trauma history plays into this and can make you more vulnerable to developing compassion fatigue, especially if that trauma is unresolved?
Yes. In the compassion fatigue resilience model, there is past traumas. But what we write about when we explain that variable is it isn't just that you've had a traumatic experience. It's what you were saying, that have you worked it through? Have you learned the lessons? Are you still tripping over things because of it? Because that's the thing that I keep saying to everyone that till I'm blue in the face, and I wish that other people would say the same thing. And that is, it's both a curse and a blessing.
Absolutely. Yeah, no doubt.
Because it can remain a curse and not a blessing if you ignore the past. We have to make peace with the past. We have to have the courage to look back on things that in the past it scared the crap out of us and that made us fearful and, you know, bury our heads in the sand. But if we're able to kind of hold on and be able to see it and be able to deal with it, then, you know, I use eye movement desensitization reprocessing. I've used other treatment approaches as well in terms of desensitization. One of the things in this treatment methodology is, the way I explain it for my clients is that what we have here on this big table, imagine a very large jigsaw puzzle. My wife, Kat, loves jigsaw puzzles. And think of it as a big, huge hole. That hole was your traumatic event. That hole was your traumatic memory. And that hole accounts for a lot of things that you don't like. But you don't want to look in that hole, and that's fine. And because no one, including clients with therapists, should be forced to do that if they don't want to. They're not ready yet, dadgummit. So leave them alone. But when they are ready, and when they do gather up the information that they were afraid to face, by God, they're starting to fill in that that jigsaw puzzle. Woo-hoo! And oh, that's a tree over there. Okay, good. So what happens in the process of desensitization is that you gather up the stuff that you heretofore were afraid to notice, really. I mean, with this particular treatment approach, you identify a scene from a traumatic event or memory that you want to work on and process and deal with and get rid of, at least the emotional sting of it. But you identify, and then you identify a scene that represents the worst aspect of that traumatic event. Whether it is having to put a kitten's life to death, or it's the realization that your buddy that you tried to save may well die on the helicopter ride back.
So Dr. Figley and I were having so much fun and just getting so in-depth with our conversation that, well, we just decided to keep talking. So I've decided to break this interview up into two parts. So I hope you will join me again next week for part two of my interview on vicarious trauma with Dr. Charles Figley. See you then. Thank you for listening to the Compassion Fatigue Podcast. Please remember to head on over to iTunes and subscribe to the show so you never miss a single episode. And don't forget to check out the CompassionFatiguePodcast.com for more great resources, including a link to join our private Facebook group. Please note that this podcast is not meant to provide medical advice or substitute for psychological care. Please consult with a mental health professional if you need additional support. And if you are feeling suicidal, please go to your nearest emergency room or call 911.